Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting in 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take some items in private. Items 4 and 5, are members content to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is the second evidence session of an inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area. Industry is the second highest carbon emitting sector in Scotland after transport. There is currently a target for 2045 for Scotland to cut greenhouse gas emissions to net zero, and Grangemouth has a significant role to play in achieving this. The committee is wishing to look, first of all, at how we can support and incentivise and de-risk this transition, firstly in the Grangemouth area, to benefit companies and individuals. And today's session will focus on the current workforce in Grangemouth and the skills needed to facilitate a just transition. So I now welcome Cliff Bowen, Executive Councillor, and Pat Rafferty, Regional Secretary from Unite the Union, Gordon McGuinness, Director of Industry and Networks, and Ronnie Palin, Regional Skills Planning Lead for Central Scotland, Skill Development Scotland, and Dominic Pritchard, National Organiser for the GMB Union. As always, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. And prior to questions, I invite members to recognise my voluntary registration of Unite membership. Does anybody else wish to, Colin Smith?
Thanks, Convener. Can I refer to my voluntary register as a member of Unite and the GMB?
Thank you. And Maggie?
Same, I'm a member of Unite. Thank you.
Thank you. Right, we'll move to questions. If I could start with questions, I'm going to come to Unite, first of all, Pat or Cliff, whoever wishes to answer. So the committee is looking at a just transition, and there is some debate around definitions of a just transition. What do you understand a just transition to mean, in particular in relation to Grangemouth? Is it principally about the plan? Is it about the wider economy? You know, what is the understanding? What do you want? And the government are about to publish their draft plan. That's due out in the spring, a draft plan for Grangemouth. Do we have a shared understanding of what a just transition will look like?
Do you want me just to
come in? It's a good question because I suppose part of that's twofold. What do you see as being just as far as a workforce is concerned? And when you look at Grangemouth particularly, because it's got such a big oil and gas sort of workforce that's based around about the Grangemouth area. And then for Unite in general, then of course we've got a big membership that sits in oil and gas offshore, in the offshore sector. And the offshore sector, of course, is linked into Grangemouth because we've got the Fortisfield pipeline coming into the plant at Grangemouth. So when we speak about a just transition, it's then about how can we ensure the longevity of the workers who are working within these sectors, in the sense of you know, the ability to move from sector to sector. So as the renewables sector begins to grow, and you know, we create manufacturing bases hopefully within that sectors, then the skills then that we've got within oil and gas sector can move sort of seamlessly, if possible, into these new sectors that are then created. And part of that, of course, again, is about terms and conditions. And, you know, if you've got somebody that's earning, you know, £50,000 to £60,000 maybe a refinery or offshore, then what sort of job skill base can we transition into earning that sort of income and that quality of life, and trying to install a confidence, if you like, in the oil and gas sector and oil and gas workforce, that when we speak about a just transition, then there is a transition that's there, and it would be just. I don't know how you measure that. I think it's going to be difficult for us. How you measure it will be about if there's 31,000 people working directly offshore on an oil platform, then where does 31,000 people go in a just transition? How many of the people have then got employment elsewhere within the economy of Scotland in different areas, in Grangemouth in particular? And I was focusing a bit on Grangemouth then. If we're all driving electric cars and, you know, net zeros, how do we get to a net zero and working allowing employers to try and reach their targets. But if we're no longer manufacturing the same liquidity going out of a refinery, we've already seen 250 jobs being lost in the refinery, then what other jobs is going to get lost as we move to more and more electric cars? I don't think we're flying about in electric planes or driving big trucks that are dingy doing electric power yet. Hydrogen will be the thing, I think, for that. But where does that workforce go then in a just transition? So I think for us, in a general sense, in just transition, it's becoming difficult to try and install a confidence in particularly the oil and gas workforce that there is actually something there that you can move to quite quickly within that transition. We're probably, the just transition is probably moving at a faster pace than we're creating jobs, I think. You know, I don't think we're creating enough jobs right now to keep pace with a just transition. I think probably the war in Ukraine and security supply has probably slowed things down a bit within oil and gas for obvious reasons. But at one point, oil and gas was becoming a kind of toxic term. So I think it's just installing the confidence in the workforce about a just transition. But a just transition for us would be about moving from one sector to another sector and, you know, keeping that security of employment and trying to keep the terms and conditions that people have been used to over the years.
Thank you. And I'll come to Dominic now. So similar to the question that Pat's addressed, but what are the challenges or the barriers? Because Pat's describing the jobs, you know, there's maybe a lack of confidence that jobs will move over. Are people clear about, is there a framework in place that people's skills can be transferred to other sectors? And are we at a stage at the moment where we're clear what those other sectors are? Because the evidence we heard last week, you know, there's quite a lot of energy sources or energy that plans that aren't yet developed or aren't yet feasible, aren't yet commercial. So where, you know, is it clear where the workforce is, where you would move them to, what the just transition future looks like?
To be quite honest, there's no clarity of where these men will go, men and women will go. Before I took up my role with GMB, I was actually one of those guys that worked on nights at Grangemouth Refinery as a welder. Most of the workforce there for these contractors is made up of short-term transient workers. Myself never ever qualified for redundancy money. So I'd never had 2 years full employment. I'm 63 this year since I served my time as a welder. Never qualified for redundancy money. Never had 2 years constant work. There is no confidence speaking to my members about a just transition. Before I came into this part of my role in GMB, for 3 years I was in the offshore sector as well. Again, vast majorities of the offshore sector are made up of short-term transient workers who stood up and stood down as the work comes in and out. What happens again is this just transition. If you want any further qualifications to move over to another sector, you pay for it yourself. Companies will not invest in their workforces because they're short-term transient workers. And there's a total lack of confidence in just transition right through the sector with the guys on the shop floor. We've seen a thing here, what Pat touched on, the likes of electric vehicles. This morning I was listening to the BBC as I was coming down for Montrose, and they were talking about how Jaguar Land Rover have got no facilities to make these electric batteries for their cars moving forward. These things are talking about sending them out to Spain, and they're volatile to transport. These are all things that we've got to look at in this country before we actually know what we are doing with a just transition, as we move, supposed to be away from oil and gas to green energy. We've also seen 177 men this week paid off at Methil. Paid off on Monday. They were told there's a 45 days notice, but if you all want to volunteer today, you can. Where's the just transition here?
I think other members will probably come to the situation in Methil and Byfab, but you know, we did have hopes there. And looking back, I think it was Unite submission had said that when the new owners came in, there was promises to create upward of 1,000 jobs. But as you've said, there has been recent redundancies at that yard. And I don't know, you know, it's concerning if that is a microcosm of where the just transition is headed. I really hope that's not, but that is a yard that was, you know, was turned around to provide for the off-wind sector, and we have lost the industrial heart of that community through the years as a result of what's happened at Byfab.
No doubt Pat's aware regarding Harland and Wolff at Methil and Arnish. They both opposed tooth and nail joint trade union recognition. Opposed it. Myself and my senior officer went out one day and we were basically insulted by a guy out there. That changed when the foreign labour weren't getting paid. And up until now, although they have in the agreement regular meetings with the trade unions, we never had one. It's a yard where one day they had welding consumables for the welders to work, but the following week they didn't have grinding stones for the platers to clean steel because they weren't paying their bills. Up to the very fact that they had no toilet paper in the place one week.
Mm-hmm. I was going to bring Pat in. I mean, there will be other members who will look at further questions on Byfab, and that as an example. But I suppose because part of achieving a just transition, there's obviously government policy, there's the role of trade unions, it's also business and industry. Do you feel that the business and industries who are based in Scotland are committed to this programme, and that they have a shared understanding of what it means?
I think the Byfab yards is probably a good example of where things start to collapse a bit when you're looking at trying to get work generated in there. And that's not all down to governments. I mean, sometimes employers need to invest and they need to put their hands in their pockets. And we kind of seen that with the Canadians who took over the Byfab yards. There's kind of their lack of investment within the yards and being prepared to put money up front themselves. The concerns clearly with Methil and the Harland and Wolff yards now is I think my kind of judgment on this is that they're likely more to concentrate on shipbuilding than what they are in renewables and offshore. That's where their sort of base comes from, and it fits more in their portfolio across Ireland and the rest of the UK. So you can see them doing more within there as opposed to trying to bid for the big contracts. But when you look at all the offshore wind contracts that's been done, Sea Green, NNG, we've got out of all of them five jackets. And I think we're struggling to do the five jackets in the Byfab yards. So we just do not have the infrastructure in place right now that can compete in the global free marketplace that where these contracts go. So, you know, the big developers will get the contracts for difference. They'll contract out to tier one contractors, and that's where it all collapses. Because it goes in a global free marketplace and we cannot compete. We cannot compete with it. We don't want to compete with the labour costs in any event in that, but we don't have the infrastructure. And then today, there's been that lack of investment in the Byfab yards. These wind farms now, they're on the seabed. You know, the Sea Green project is the deepest offshore wind farm in the world. It's the deepest in the world. So the technologies that's getting done right now is globally leading, but we're not doing it. We don't have that. Some of these are 59 metres deep. The Byfab yards don't have the craneage to even lift things that size. So, and it does link all into Grange, but all these things are kind of interconnected, and you need the manufacturing bases, supply chains to do that. You've got the green free ports now, so Forth Valley is one of the green free ports. You want to capitalise on that green free port. So there'll be concerns, of course, about are you just going to be shifting labour if it's somewhere else in Scotland into a Green Free Port, and that area suffers as a result of that. You hope the Green Free Ports generate new work coming internationally for across the globe, and it's creating new jobs. But we have a big, I mean, we've got Scotland that is a big opportunity, but the difficulty will be where does that manufacturing base go on the land? Mm-hmm. And if it goes out to contracts for difference and thing, then I'm very sceptical. Yeah. CS Wind and Macrahanish went under into liquidation, the only onshore wind tower manufacturer in the whole of the UK. So the bit that you see on the ground that's up there with the thingies, that was the only one in the UK. And the Koreans came in, took the company and ran it into the ground. And we had to such a degree with the interim interdicts placed on the site to stop them assetting, stripping the site. So when we talk about just transition, going back to just transitions again, then that doesn't instill confidence in a workforce about. We're not hearing announcements taking place every other week about, you know, 500 jobs here. Or, now, there might well be. I can see the Cromarty Firth has got a big opportunity, it's, you know, to get involved in the. But it might well be that it's just going to assemble things. Things are going to get manufactured elsewhere, come in on a big diesel power ship, and come in to Scotland and get assembled there and then put out.
If you're...
Hydrogen,
Because I will have other members who'll come in about green free ports and some of these borders issues. Okay, we'll return to that. I'll let other members, if that's okay, Mr. Bowen. I'll just ask a final question to SDS and I'll invite Fiona Hislop to come in. The Climate Skills Emergency Action Plan was published in December 2020, and I think the government have promised a refresh plan to come forward in 2023. But, you know, what evaluation has been done of the 2020 initial plan, and, you know, has it achieved the desired outcomes? It's quite short to be looking at a refresh from December 2020 to 2023. Isn't really much time to be looking at it.
The climate emergency plan, when we undertook it at first, I think initially SDS was going to focus on the areas of high carbon employment, and government asked us to align with our own work around the kind of climate emergency, so it became a very broad document. I think through the work that we've done, we've kind of tried to focus on the kind of key areas, so we've had two work packages, one looking at actually, and it might sound daft, but just actually defining what a kind of green job is and getting some kind of definition around that. And that report was published in November last year. So it kind of tries to bring some sense to it. So it reckons about 40% of jobs in Scotland will be impacted by the transition to net zero in some way. And that's either because there are going to be changes to existing job roles in terms of the technology that comes in. There either going to be completely new roles that emerge as technology is implemented, or there's going to be a requirement for more staff of a particular discipline. So in one of the submissions to the committee, I think Select, which is the trade body for electricians, flagged that there was a demand for more electricians because of the technology, heat pumps and ground source heat pumps, for more technicians of that level. So I think that's been a kind of key piece of work. The other piece that we've been doing is looking at further and higher education in terms of the changes that they may need to make to some of their provision as we move on. I think when it comes to investment in that space, probably both from a government and from an SDS point of view, to make a real impact, then we probably need a bit more investment into to direct action into some of these areas. We've worked on things like the greening of apprenticeships, but we could do more in that space with a bit more resource. But I think we appreciate across the board that the public funds are under pressure. So we've tried to adapt our programme to meet those needs. Government has indicated that they're going to do the refresh by the end of 2023, and we're working with them and with industry to actually help them in terms of that refresh programme.
And last week, I'll bring Fiona in a second, but last week we had Forth Ports in, you know, they were questioned about the job figure, because I think some of the frustration being expressed by the unions about confidence within the workforce, there's lots of high numbers, oh, there'll be 10,000 more jobs here, and people struggle to see them being materialised. Is there, you know, do you as an organisation, is there targets and job figures that you're attached to the plans, and are they, do you think they have the confidence of the of workforce?
I mean, we are working in Scottish Enterprise, and Scottish Government made a submission on behalf of the Grangemouth Future Industry Forum. We're working alongside them with that. It's probably too early, in my opinion, to be very specific about what the opportunities might be and when they might materialise. And I think we can only work alongside them. Pat made the point around, I guess, oil and gas. And I've done a lot of work with the sector when prices took a kind of serious dip. And you're right, Pat was right in terms of it was viewed as a kind of toxic sector, and that's where people were looking to move from that and going back to the kind of just transition element. That's changed, obviously, with what's happened in Ukraine and security of supply. And therefore, I think the life expectancy around Grangemouth in terms of petrochemicals probably extends as well. So that transition to the new technologies, I don't think it necessarily displaces it, moves it back, but I think there will need to be space on the Grangemouth campus to actually utilise both the existing and new technologies as they come in.
Okay, thank you. Mr Palin, did you want to add anything, or I'll bring in? I think Ms Hislop has several line of questions, so I'll bring in.
Good morning, thank you for joining us. Clearly just transition is a massive area, and we will look at sort of broader areas, but we do want to focus on Grangemouth today, almost sort of drill into it to give us an illustration. So the committee has heard that we've already have a fairly developed understanding of skills required for the next 5 years or so, the transition. Do you agree with that? And how confident are you that Scotland's skills system will provide the necessary skills in the right numbers at the right time to meet this anticipated demand? So this is the short term for the next 5 years. If I can maybe come to you first, Gordon, from STS, and then I'll come to the union representatives.
I think, and again, the consultation accepted a response in from Forth Valley College. It's probably the college in Scotland that from an industrial perspective works closest with the range of industrial partners. A huge investment in the new campus. They deliver the biggest number of engineering apprenticeships for us. So I think the complex is well served from an academic point of view in terms of further education. It does have relationships into higher education, and it's about how those work over. So I am confident over the next 5 years that there is a strong provision there. Beyond that, then, I think there's a degree of working with industry, trying to anticipate and plan for what happens next. So how does hydrogen go from being a product to being able to service the domestic households, that type of thing? That's still evolving. The technology, we're not, I guess, technical experts, so we need to engage with industry itself, so with Scottish Gas, with the Scottish Power Energy Networks and others like that, to understand how hydrogen-type systems will be implemented. Carbon capture and storage, as I explained to Ronnie, we've done our first plan, first energy skills investment plan, probably 2012. We anticipated there'd be something like 18,000 people employed in carbon capture and storage at this stage. That investment from the UK government's never really came to realise those initial projects. So there's still a whole industry that's going to actually develop and mature around that. Some of the skill sets will be similar, but will just be deployed into a different technology.
So for the next 5 years, from what you were saying earlier, you're probably focusing on electricians, heat pumps, that kind of area for the next 5 years. Is that fair to say?
Engineering and technical skills.
But let's move on then a bit to what you've just been talking about. And Forth Ports themselves have noted that after 2030, the requirements are less clear of what's needed. The new emerging technologies, as you said, with hydrogen in particular, they might demand new skills. So how confident are you that Scotland's skills system can put structures in place to identify and respond to these potential emerging demands for skills in a timely manner. And a lot of the focus is looking at young apprentices or new people coming in or younger people coming in to the college, etc. But we need to get back to the just transition issue about what can we put in place for older workers.
I think, take it to the side of it, I think we look at organisations where that's worked really well. So you get somebody like Scottish and Southern Energy, and they've now published two reports, so a deep engagement with their workforce in terms of what that transition means for them as individuals, and then what type of support do people want to actually move across from carbon-intensive roles to greener roles. So I think there, that's a really good example of where communication has come in, but also skills enhancement and support. Because you're right, the workforce that's there is probably going to be the one that will be there in 10 years' time. So that kind of process of, explaining the technologies, taking some of the fear factor out of it, and there's obviously going to be concerns around things like job security, so whatever kind of comfort and assurance can be given around that. But all the kind of indications are positive in terms of job growth. You asked about levels of confidence. One of the challenges just now, I think, are around labour supply and availability of people, and less on the kind of technical competence of our colleges and universities in terms of being able to support and work with people. I think we have a fantastic college estate across Scotland. I'd like to see it open a few more evenings a week and maybe even at a weekend, because that's when people have time to engage in learning and face-to-face stuff. And I think that's something that we need to look at, particularly for a site the size of Grangemouth with a concentration of workers in that area.
And can I maybe come to Unite first and then to Dominic? Any reflections on this in the short term, but also in the longer term? And what does that mean for older workers? And actually, part of what we want to do is come up with suggestions of what you think it should look like. And is that SSE model quite a good one, particularly for, you know, that way forward for maybe the Grangemouth area?
Yeah, and good morning, everybody. I can't tell you how happy I am to be here. So I'm the executive councillor for Unite for the sector, but I'm also the convener at Ineos in Grangemouth. So, and I live in Grangemouth, and I've worked there for 31 years, so pretty well-stead to give the background and where we're heading and stuff. And I think, first of all, what I'd like to say is people within our sector, but within Grangemouth particularly, you know, we realise and recognise the need to decarbonise. You know, we've been talking about this for a long time in this sector. And when I left the school 30 years ago and I fell into the refinery in Grangemouth, the life that this industry has gave me has been, I would have ripped your arms off for it, right? A working class kid for Grangemouth and the life that I've had. And I guess for me, my mission statement, if you like, is to try and encourage that and try and engender that for working class kids in that area for the next 20, 30 years. And I think, you know, we talk about just transitioning and we talk about skills and stuff. At Grangemouth, we talk about the Grangemouth site as being a net exporter of talent, right, for oil and gas world and for chemicals, right, because highly skilled workforce that we have there, right, with transferable skills, it's pretty easy. Do you know, like, so we took all our lead conveners and activists from chemicals, pharmaceuticals and refineries across the UK. And everybody talks about just transition and about carbon capture and about hydrogen and stuff, right? But for me, it's, you know, there's a lot of talk, right? But what does it mean? So we went down to Imperial College in London, right? And they've got a carbon capture storage facility there. Because we wanted to understand exactly your point, right? Because we did a lot of work in mental health, right? And you talk about just transition. So what does it mean for older workers, right?
Yeah.
Right? What does it mean for the workers, you know, who the GMB are talking about here, right? What does it mean for... But I can only talk to the people who work in the installations. That's more the contract workforce. I'm talking about the core workers that work on these sites and in my sector, right? So you talk about, you know, upskilling and the constant need to upskill and all that. But what does that mean to somebody who is a mechanically minded person, right? Everybody in this room, right, has got a niche that they're good at, right, that they go to, right? Everybody around here, you know, they'll be comfortable in the space that they work in, right? If you're a mechanically minded person, you're a maintenance person, right? You like getting your hands and stuff. You like getting bolts and nuts and spanners and stuff. If you're an instrument person, you're a bit more analytical, electrical, different skill set again. So if we're telling people who are electrically minded, by the way, we need you to change, and we need you to change, by the way, pretty quickly, because I've never seen a change in my sector at such a rate of knots at the minute. You know, everything's changing day by day. So we're saying, we need you to change there, right? So what does that do to their mental health, right? And what do we do with these workers that can't upskill, right, that can't transition? So we took all these key activists and we went to Imperial College and we had a look at carbon capture, and it's actually pretty straightforward. Do you know hydrogen? Pretty straightforward. We use, but hydrogen's a byproduct of a lot of the systems that we have at Grangemouth. So we understand these things, and I guess what I would say is this: if we move people from plant to plant, or me as a technician, right? If I was to move from an ethane plant to a benzene plant, for instance, right? All I need to understand, right, as an engineer, as a technician, as an electrician, as a maintenance person, is what pressure is it at? What temperature is it at? What does it look like if it escapes? What do I need to know? Is it toxic? Is it a carcinogen? See, once I understand that, you give me 3 to 6 months and I'll be able to run that plant for you, right? So the transition to hydrogen, to carbon capture, to Project Acorn, for us as a workforce at Grangemouth, I'm not saying it's going to be simple, right, because it's complex. I mean, it's hydrogen's 1.2 billion investment in Grangemouth site. I mean, it's big cash, you know, but these are jobs for the future. I'm the convener at FPS, which is the Forties pipeline system, which is the most critical piece of infrastructure. Sorry if I'm preaching, like, if you all know, like, but I'm just letting you know, like, for those that don't. Most critical piece of infrastructure for gas, oil and gas supply for the UK. And we're open to 2040, 2045, right? We understand the need to decarbonise. We get it, right? But we are on this. We're doing this already, right? We have a Grangemouth Energy Network. So it's all these key young technicians and engineers who really do they're echoing the stuff that I've heard here about, you know, like we had seen for a bit like people maybe wanting to leave our industry, right? But now people are staying because we're going to be the ones that will decarbonize this, and we've set up these teams, right, that go, right, look, this process here, can you go and have a look at that for us, right, and tell us how we can decarbonize that? And we've got like 10 or 12 projects at the Grangemouth site already, right, that are going on at the minute that are decarbonizing that site. So in terms of the, you know, the future, do you know, it's long term, you know, we have these targets for 2030, for 2045. And in terms of, you know, you asked about skills and about, you know, about older workers and stuff, it's actually just STEM stuff. Do you know, that's all we really need. We need the investment for the colleges. You know, we've got great apprenticeships and stuff like that. The apprentice programme we have is first class. The kids that we produce out of those apprenticeships, they're highly skilled people when they come out, you know, and they can go and work anywhere on the planet at any time. But they're staying at Grangemouth because they see the future there. Mm-hmm. You know, you talk about Acorn, you talk about carbon capture, hydrogen. It really is quite a simple transfer for us. Like, hey, what we do need is investment in infrastructure, because what business is telling me up and down the country is, you know, we're willing to go and we're willing to invest in hydrogen, but where is the infrastructure? If you take Germany, for example, there's an app you can get in your phone in terms of filling stations for your hydrogen cars. In Germany, there's something like 90 hydrogen filling stations. In the UK, there's 10 and there's only 2 works. So why would business go and invest all this money in hydrogen? And 1.2 billion is a lot of cash, right? That is a lot of real money, like, that's going to go into Grangemouth site. That'll create these long-term jobs for the future. Good, well-paid manufacturing jobs that working-class kids like me will be able to enjoy and put all that money back into the economy, right? Clean fuels, decarbonised. But why are we going to do that if there's no plan for infrastructure and stuff? So we need a bit of that as well. But in terms of the skill set stuff and the just transition piece we're speaking at the minute, for older workers, for newer workers, it's not going to be that difficult for us, is the truth of the matter. And we've actually got quite a bright outlook at Grangemouth on this stuff. And that's why I said to you, I really welcome these conversations, because we've been talking about this for a long time within Unite, right? And particularly in my sector. But as a Portonian who lives in the town, really, really welcomed. Pretty straightforward. We're on the mental health stuff. We get it. We understand it. But the transferability of skills will be quite simple for us. We just need this pipeline of kids that are coming through for the Grangemouth area from the central belt, if you like. Because when the apprenticeship advert goes in the Falkirk Herald, right, I'm the best. I'm everybody's best friend, right? Because everybody wants their kids in there, right? People will tell you that people are turning away from an industry. That's not what we see, right? We get thousands of people applying for these apprenticeships because they understand there's a long-term future there. And if you look through the lens of a decarbonised site, which is where we're all trying to get to, I grew up in Grangemouth Park, grew up in Grangemouth, right? The sky in Grangemouth when I was little was orange. It used to vibrate with the flares, right? Last year, we've had some of the lowest flaring totals we've ever seen. And we're also putting more money into ground flares there. So, you know, the emissions are cut all the time. So the future's bright for that site, like, and in terms of skills, the pipeline, if we just continue where we're going, the STEM stuff, I think there is some stuff we need to do with schools. I have a 14-year-old, and he was picking his subjects last year, and I spoke to his guidance teacher about, you know, green jobs, you know, what green energy, green jobs, green skills. where is this stuff? Do you know, like, what should they be studying? What science is it? Is it physics? Is it still chemistry? Is it biology? Is it general science? Is it environmental science? Because when I was at school, it was physics and chemistry. That was all you needed, right? Never worry about the rest if you want to go and work in my industry. And the girl, and God bless the teachers and the nurses that kept us afloat, the working class people afloat during COVID and stuff, she didn't know what I was talking about, eh? She didn't understand where I was going with the conversation about green skills and green energy. So there's this joint between, you know, the education piece and what industry are telling us. And I'll finish on this, because I appreciate I've spoke about there, like, but I've been waiting for a long time for this.
I can tell.
When we went to Imperial College, right, and this will just illustrate my point, right? We had, Imperial College, it's the cream, the real boffins, right, science and stuff like that we were dealing with. All these young kids, very enthused. It was great to see. And we had a professor there with more letters after his name than you can care to imagine, Colin Hale, like, hey, a very interesting guy. So we had them in the morning, and we had the CIA, the Chemical Industry Association, in the afternoon, and we had the executive guy for that, the chief executive for there. And he was telling us in the morning, he says, look, we're worried, we can't get kids to come into this industry and stuff like that. Like, hey, what business is telling us, we're struggling to attract talent. We then take all these key activists and conveners to Imperial College with all these wee boffins, right? And I mean, they were superb, right? Very enthused and stuff. Talking about all this stuff, decarbonisation, let's get after this stuff. And they were running this plant, and they were only kids, right? And they were up, they're running, pumps going, all this kind of stuff. And they said to us when we were leaving, can we give you our CVs? Right, because we're struggling to get jobs, right? And I said, I had a meeting with Ed Miliband, Pat and I met with Ed Miliband in Birmingham to talk about exactly what we're talking about today, right? And I said to him, and I'll say it to you today, how can it be that a union convener for Grangemouth, right, is having the conversation to try and join up Imperial College, the CIA, and we kind of get people, we kind of get jobs. How can that be? Do you know, so there's some, we need something to join all that up. And then if I use the illustration of me talking to my kid's guidance teacher, there is this wee breakdown, you know. We don't want to be seen as a sunset industry. We want to be seen as a sunrise, you know. We want to be known as green workers, right, because we are going to decarbonise, right? People can protest, and it's very laudable, you know, like gluing themselves to roads and chucking stuff at paintings. I get all that, right? I understand it all, right, and I understand the frustration. But we'll be the ones that decarbonise it. And, you know, it'll be government, it'll be employers, and it'll be unions that will help to decarbonise and save the planet, eh? And then save the
world. OK, thank you very much, Cliff. And that was definitely worth the wait, as I hope, from you. And certainly that's what we want to do, is to provide that spotlight on what is possible and how it can be done. And thank you so much for that contribution. We've learned a lot from that. Very briefly, because
It's on the digital passport stuff, yeah. Because we are working a lot. It's about, clearly as you say, about upskilling the older workforce within the oil and gas sector. So we're doing a lot of work on the digital passport, mainly concentrating just now on upstream and the offshore platforms. But that's not to stop that from coming downstream. And actually, we're speaking now to INEOS about being part of that digital passport. So the transferable skills is there. We can see what skills is required to move from oil and gas to wind or to things, and then upskill people to make that transition. So we are looking at going downstream as well as upstream on that. Yeah.
And Dominic, if GMB is what you were focusing more on short term, and the concern about they have to pay for their training, etc., when we'll need the labour and we'll need their skills. So what would you suggest in terms of what's needed?
We've got a situation here where we've got. I left school in 1977, started my time as a welder. A lot of kids at that time didn't get their apprenticeships and whatever. People went on to youth opportunity schemes and whatever. People were lost, full generations were lost to training and apprenticeships. A lot of guys that I went to school with at that time came into the industry as semi-skilled workers, etc. Now, we have in the engineering and construction agreement with Unite and ourselves are joint signatories to. We have got a continuous improvement scheme there where guys who were semi-skilled, etc., could move up into trades with training that wasn't as academically onerous as what you'd get an apprentice coming in at 17 with. So it's based more on core manual labour skills, etc. Now the thing is this, Alexa, apart from one engineering and construction companies in Britain, none of the rest of them have got proper facilities to train people. They're relying on colleges, etc. Now, the thing is, we're now in the worst skill shortage in over 40 years at this moment in time. These guys would be happy, willing to be trained up, but we don't have the facilities for them. They also don't have any... They're struggling to get funding for them as well, because although they pay the ECITB levies, everybody is drawing on that. And the thing is this, if you do not use it for your industry, it goes to other places. So for talking to a company like Motherwell Bridge, who maybe want to train people up, don't have anywhere to send them. But Tesco can then take that funding to use it elsewhere. So we're losing the funding, but their levies are getting paid into as well. And this is a thing that is happening right throughout the whole of industry, engineering and construction, whether it is in there, in Grangemouth or elsewhere. We have got guys in there who could fill quite quickly the skill shortage, i.e. pipefitters, mates, who have been working alongside pipefitters day in, day out, doing a lot of the work that the pipefitter would have done. But because he hasn't got the funding now to move them on, we're losing these. The guys aren't progressing, and it's not filling the hole here for a skilled workforce.
That's very helpful. I'm going to ask Gordon if he could maybe respond to Dominic as to how what is the solution and his skills development working on that. And then my final question also to you as well, my other question is, we understand that the latest sectoral skills assessment for the energy sector, that you expect the workforce to reduce by 2.5% by 2032. So what needs to be done to make sure there's sufficient opportunities in other sectors to offset this reduction? And how can we ensure that these new opportunities will be highly skilled and highly quality jobs? So you've got people who are prepared to move and trained, but can't get trained. You know there's going to be a shortfall in the future. So how do you join up the dots with what Dominic's saying?
So part of what Dominic's described has been short-term contract work, and I think that's a challenge, certainly a challenge in terms of... and I think some of that might change because the labour market is getting tighter. So we've got evidence of companies shifting the balance of their core workforce to their contractors quite dramatically, because when prices are going up and if they offer job security, there's more liability or more likelihood that they will stick with the company. What Dominic's describing, though, is a challenge in terms of people with a mid-set of skills, and you're looking to upskill them to probably below the apprenticeship. We can do mature apprenticeships, again, it requires a resource to do that. But that kind of mid-skill set is probably a bit of a gap. The colleges, and we've been having discussions with the funding council, there's probably more we can do in that space, particularly for those who are in shorter term contracts and maybe not earning as much. And I'm happy to follow up with Dominic and have conversations with Forth Valley to see if we could do something on a regional basis around that area. Government, and it's within the NSET strategy, are looking at that kind of lifetime learning offer. So we're working with colleagues in our sponsor division to look what that might look like in the future. And that's presenting itself in different ways of the need for that. So Pat touched on Cromarty. So we've got a kind of need for coded welders up there. Now that's short, sharp training. It's not a long course. It's probably a week and then assessment. And probably cost for that about £2,000. Currently, there's nothing within the skills system that does that. We don't have a career development loan system at anywhere in the UK now that would, be able to tap into that to then reimburse it. So I think we need to look constructively at a whole range of things, and it's perhaps making a contribution towards individuals that are going to upskill themselves as opposed to paying for the full amount, because it gets back to ideally be looking for employers if they're going to benefit from those enhanced skills for them to be contributing into that space as well.
So we're hearing what we don't have, what we want to do is what do we need, and then that's part of what we'll have.
Well, there's one point there, Alex, in the engineering and construction sector, these guys, what I was talking about there, their pay grade is grade 3, which is 20% less than an advanced craftsman. So realistically speaking, an advanced craftsman now on Grangemouth is £19.11 plus a second tier payment bonus. So as you can see, it's quite an attractive wage, even as a semi-skilled operative in there. So the financial part for that guy's wages, because while he's actually doing his learning there, is still getting paid at 20% less than the craft rate, the advanced craftsman. So it isn't as if he's having to take a drop in wages at that point to get trained. So we've not got a problem on the lights or the financial aspect here for the actual operative. Where we have the problem here is getting these guys trained. Okay. The only company that actually does it in any scale is Babcock's. They've got a massive school down at Tipton, mm-hmm. where they take the guys in and they take them in and they give them so much of the training. The likes of the welders are in there constantly. I've been in there myself many a time. And what I'm saying is the other guys get sent down for a block release for the likes of pipe fitting, plating, etc., rigging, and then they do a lot of on-site training. So it isn't as if it's the financial side of it. It's more the fact of getting these guys actual trainers with the likes of Balfour Beatty or Motherwell Bridge or companies like that. It's not the financial side of it.
I'm very conscious that's been quite a long time, so I'll better have him back to the convener. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, we do value the contributions this morning. We have, as myself and Fiona Hislop here to blame, but we have used up 50 minutes of the session already. So if I ask members to be concise, some of the areas, we've been quite broad in discussion so far, some areas people intended to ask might already been covered. But I'll come to Maggie Chapman to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, and good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning. I want to just pick up on a couple of points from Unite's submission. You've talked about the just transition having to be worker-led, and you've obviously talked about some of the issues that you face just now. But I was wondering if you could just give us a little bit more detail about what worker leadership looks like. What's missing, and what it is that we can actually do to make sure that we get that worker-led just transition?
I think I've never been so violently in agreement with an employer in all my life, right, when it comes to this stuff. And it's
are you sure you want that on the record?
No, but we are, do you know, like, and this, do you know, everybody, like I said to you right at the start of my last submission, everybody recognises the need to decarbonise, right? We get it. And, you know, Ineos, clearly like Grangemouth, if you're talking about Grangemouth, needs to be, they want to still be in business. People that live in the locale, they want these good, well-paid jobs, you know. People can talk about green jobs, you know. It's a green job to me isn't delivering pizza on an electric bike, right? And there's a tenuous link to that. But if I think about a green job, it's a 30-year career, 25, 30-year career, that's going to lift working-class kids. And I'm not quite saying in poverty, you know, but I live in Grangemouth and there are areas that are impoverished, right? And I'm not quite saying that this isn't a tale of woe for me, but I was a working class kid that probably didn't come from much, and the house I stay in, the car I drive, the future I've been able to give my kids, I'd ripped your arms off for. And I think the job of work for us is to be able to keep that going. And in terms of your point about you know, how it works, you know, this is about worker voice, right, as well as it can't just be seen about, you know, industry trying to make cash, because it's about worker voice. And we have had discussions with the company at every single level in this. You know, I talk about this stuff all the time, right? I'm everybody's best pal now. This is just like apprenticeship week at Ineos, right? Because it's at European Works Council level. It's the way that Ineos is set up. You know, they have the owners, and then they have a guy who works for them, a director, a guy called Tom Crotty. I've had discussions with this all the time. Pat and I have met with him. You know, we've met with the Labour Party. We're coming to speak to everybody here today. And it's all with this joint aim of, you know, the country's still going to need the goods that we create at Grangemouth, right? It's still going to need energy, right? If the thing we've learned about Putin and stuff like that, I mean, just look at the way people's bills have been affected by this, these global issues that affect us. So you talk about security supply and about energy and about all that stuff. And a decarbonised world, right, that we can create through these changes at Grangemouth in our processes and our systems, whether it be through electrification, whether it be through carbon capture, whether it be through this hydrogen plants and stuff. We need to be at the centre of that, and we really are. Do you know, like, the employers are listening. Do you know, they're listening to us. We're talking at all levels. Do you know, we're out. We're talking about to the younger workers. We're convincing them there's a future for them. Do you know, you talk about apprenticeships. These apprenticeships are first class. Do you know, and if we can continue, do you know, through the schools and get into the schools and talk to these young kids coming through and saying, like, look, there is a future for you here. Do you know what I mean? These jobs. I've got friends who are contractors. My brother-in-law was a contractor for years, right? People are wanting these jobs, right? But if they don't know they're there, do you know, like a fitter's mate's a well-paid job, do you know, a pipe fitter's mate, they're well-paid jobs, these, but if the kids didn't know they're there, they didn't know where to look and they didn't know where to go with their skill sets and stuff, eh? But to come back to your point about the just transition and the involvement in it, it's just key for them, workers, to be listened to. And I think, actually, do you know, as an example of how this can move into different areas of the economy and different sectors, I think the Grangemouth model, we've got it pretty spot on this time, like, eh? And I've been involved in this game for 31 years, and I said to you right at the start, I was BP for 25 years, and I didn't ever feel as engaged in a process as I do at the minute, like, eh? I'm at the heart of all this stuff. Do you know, if I go to the company and ask for information on, do you know, I said I'm coming here today, do you know what I mean? It's like, what do you need? Do you know what I mean? Like, well, we have this real joined-up approach, right, that says, look, how are we going to keep this site open for the next 20, 30 years, for everybody, for the good of everybody, like, and actually, for the good of the, sounds a bit ironic, like, but for the good of the planet as well, because, you know, the easiest thing for us to do, right, is to shut all these places down in the UK, right, and then we'll just import for China, for India and all that stuff, but everybody in this room recognises that is not the way to go about this, right, because they're not as regulated as we are with this stuff, right, so we are well up for decarbonisation, like I've said to you, right? We've got these processes in place. We've got all these. If you want to know more about these projects that we've got on, like, hey, we can get you a visit to the site. If anybody wants to come, you know, we've got Ed Miliband coming on the 24th of March. We're a delegation for Labour. We'll talk to anybody about this stuff, right? Because, well, it's no part of political, this, because it's about the future of the planet and it's the future of Grangemouth, eh?
Sorry, carry on, Pat.
I mean, Cliff's been a good example of where you go, a good engagement with an employer that wants to reach out and actually listen to the workforce and how best you can make the transition. We've got difficulties with other employers, though, and so we're not all like that, and I wish they were. And offshore, in particularly, is difficult just because of the logistics of offshore. Mm-hmm. And there is a huge workforce in oil and gas and offshore. And the supply chains that come through that, the GEA figures about 200,000 upwards in supply chains that's linked to oil and gas. So it's getting the type of models that's happening in Grangemouth right now to happen across all the different sectors. It's a challenge, I think, for us to try and achieve that.
And what can we do to help with that? Because I think you're right, it is a challenge. And if the model is working, how can we transfer it across? But what's stopping it? What are the barriers?
Well, I think, you know, you've got the Fair Work agenda, mm-hmm. and that's there, that you know, that's fundamental, and, you know, within the government itself. So I think you can apply political pressure on some of these employers, mm-hmm. to make sure that they are engaging with the workforce and are engaging with the recognised trade unions that are representing that workforce. So whatever political pressure you can apply through the Fair Work agenda, okay. that would be helpful for us.
Okay. Thanks. And Dominic, you talked about the failure of companies to recognise trade unions. What other than political pressure, what do you see as our role in supporting that worker-led just transition?
Well, I think what I would say is this: it's not just been companies that have actually been in the way of the unions in this country, in Scotland at this moment in time, because at the very start of this green energy was these biomass plants, etc., Miller Hill, just along the road there, etc., where the councils, Aberdeen, Dundee, Edinburgh, Glasgow, every one of them put obstacles to having the recognised trade union agreement in there for engineering and construction. Every one of them. And we've seen what a train crash every one of these, mm-hmm. these energy waste plants have been. Now, that was one of the first jobs I was tasked with in the GMB at that time, to link up with my colleagues within Unite up in Aberdeen, Dundee, Edinburgh, to try and get these projects done under the national agreements. And politicians from all colours kept telling us, but as long as you pay a Scottish living wage, that is fine. We had foreign labour coming in here who were exploited, totally exploited, because they were in here as a cheap option. Mm-hmm. And it also kept our members out of work, up and down the country. And this is the reasons why we have mistrust within Just Transition, etc. here, because we've not seen anything at all. We've not gained anything out of it whatsoever up until... And this is why we're sitting here the now waiting to see what's actually going to happen.
And so how do we make sure that the contracted workers, the transient workforce, is actually brought into those conversations? What is it that we need to do to make sure that you are brought into those conversations?
Realistically speaking, what you should be doing is writing in national agreements into any discussions whatsoever, mm-hmm. making it mandatory, not just an invitation to us. And then somebody then comes up with try and give you an explanation of why it shouldn't happen. Now, we brought national officers, Bernard McCauley for Unite the Union, and also Stevie Kemp, and up to Aberdeen. And we were met with resistance. Mm-hmm. We took our own officers up to Dundee for Bulldovey. Again, we were met with resistance. These councils were handing these out to engineering procurement contractors, who then brought people in to basically stop the unions and not have any engagement with them. And they didn't only do it in Scotland, they've done it right across Britain. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, as I say, you've got a transient workforce who were seeing green energy jobs built on their doorsteps. And we're being locked
out. Not part of it. Okay.
Now, I live in the East End of Glasgow, and I couldn't get on that job at Paul Madee.
Okay. And I suppose, Pat and Dominic, you talked about BIFAB earlier. Can I just ask, is there anything else, given the job losses that have happened over successive periods in the past, what is it that the Scottish Government, other national bodies, other public agencies need to do to prevent that kind of job loss happening again? At BIFAB or equivalent sites elsewhere?
Well, it's Harland and Wolff now. BIFAB do not mm-hmm. exist. What you need is total investment to revamp these yards. At the end of the day, these yards are... I worked in Methil way back in the early 80s. And when BIFAB was going on, I was up. I was part of the GMB party to oppose that. Mm-hmm. And when I walked into that yard, I was absolutely shocked about how filthy it was. Whereas... when it was RGC and we were building a big jackets for the North Sea, the place was in pristine condition. It was still hard work because there wasn't a great deal of investment in it. Mm-hmm. But if anything, it had went back for what I've seen then. And what I have seen this time when I was in it, walking around it, it is even worse. These yards need a total revamp. Basically, you have got places abroad building these jackets in specialised conditions. The way you would liken it is like these places, it's a production line for Rolls Royce against the cheapest car you can get. And that's where mm-hmm. Harland and Wolff are. At this moment in time, they're telling us that they're going to build a couple of barges, but they're going to get off Belfast. Personally speaking, with the workforce that they're leaving there, I can't see how they'll do it. They're telling me that now, and I've got the paperwork here, 13 welders, 13 platers. Right away, that's not a proper skills match because there should be 2 platers to every welder, at least. Right. So that's putting ringing alarm bells in my mind. I do not think that place will be open much longer. It'll be mothballed.
Does this complete lack of investment over the years at the BIFAB yards? It's just... Other countries have invested heavily in infrastructure to get themselves into a position that they're ready for that marketplace coming their way. The danger for us in Scotland is, have we missed that boat? Mm. Has the ship sailed as far as that goes? Because, you know, as we said about Macrahanis and CS Wind and BIFAB, you're struggling to see. Even with BIFAB and Methil, some of these platforms now for offshore wind, you need deep water. You need deep water to put these jackets in. I don't even think you've got deep water of methyl that could take some of these jackets. They'd need to, you know, they'd need to dredge the water of methyl. So Cromarty Firth is probably deeper. And you've got an opportunity at Cromarty Firth, but if you don't invest in Cromarty Firth, if you don't get Acorn, looking back to what Cliff was speaking about at Grangemouth, if you can't get Acorn up and running and carbon capture taking place, then that puts a blocker on hydrogen at Grangemouth. We need carbon capture. Depending on what hydrogen path you're going to go down, if you go down blue hydrogen, we need carbon capture. We'd like to all go down green hydrogen, but we're not quite there yet for trying to get green hydrogen or pink hydrogen. There's all these different colours of hydrogen, isn't it? With nuclear-based hydrogen. Any of us would like small nuclear. I know that's just not going to happen. But that's what they would like, is small nuclear to be in there. And then you get pink hydrogen coming through. But if you don't make these capital investments, you're going to miss that boat in the same way as you're missing the whole offshore wind contracts. We're not going to get... We just don't have the infrastructure. We don't have it.
We had meetings with the Norwegian oil minister 2 weeks ago, talking about all the same stuff, the same rhetoric I've gave you this morning, and they get it. You know, we speak to our colleagues in Industrial, which is a global union federation that Unite are part of. And I mean, you talk to the Germans, they're miles ahead of us in terms of this stuff. And it's like I said to you earlier on about, you know, industry is ready to hit the button on hydrogen, right? £1.2 billion, right, is going to go into Grangemouth, like, on the back of hydrogen, right? And on the back of Acorn. But there's a real frustration there, right? And also making a car, this Grenadier car that they make, right? And there's a hydrogen one going to be coming out on the back. Shortly, they're going to make an electric version, then a hydrogen fuel cell version, right? But if you were to go and try and buy a hydrogen car today, right, in the UK, you wouldn't buy one, right? Because, one, you probably couldn't get one, and two, there's nowhere to fill up, right? In Germany, you know, they've got a thing in Germany. I speak to my German colleagues, right? And there's a kind of mantra in Germany and policy that says, you know, there'll not be a town or city in Germany that'll not be 30 kilometres away from a hydrogen filling station, right? And they're away. They've got 90, right? You can buy cars there with hydrogen they know. In the UK, we talk about it and stuff, and you better believe in a global market, right? And it was built this, they built this plant, back to the point here about the negative press and that you get, right? And it was built this plant within Flanders, right? And they could have built it anywhere on the planet, right? But they built it in Flanders, right? And the rhetoric that you get, right, from certain movements, right, is, oh, it's just another chemical plant, right? But it's not just another chemical plant, right? It's the first investment of that type within anywhere in Europe in the last 20 years, right? Millions and millions of pounds. Thousands of jobs created, right? And it's going to be the first net zero cracker within Europe, right? So it's not a chemical plant. It is a chemical plant. But it's going to be a carbon-neutral chemical plant. So what is it that we're trying to achieve? Do you know, do we want jobs? Do we want well-paid jobs? Do we want to decarbonise? Or do we just want to ship it on? Because we're going to... Nobody likes a cold shower, right? And anybody that... And, do you know, and that's not a flippant comment there, right? But, I mean, everybody looks at their own fuel bills in their house at the minute, right? I mean, my kids have never been so cold, right? Right? I mean, I'm not saying they're frozen, right? But they're what about going, Dad, get that heating on? And I'm like, are you joking? My fuel bills have went up to about... I'm about £800, and I didn't stay in a mansion, right? I've not got a massive house, like, eh? But I went from £120 to £800 at the top end of it all. That's not sustainable, right? But if we didn't get this stuff right... If I look at the deals that are getting done across their industry at the minute, it's America under the IRA stuff that's going on over there. Because they're just like, in you's come, and global capital's gone, yep, and it's China, right? You look at the deals that are getting done in China at the minute, right, round the bit, and it's all about securing energy for the future. If we didn't start to get this stuff right in this country, as Pat has already said, and your colleague to the left have already said, we're not even at starting blocks in this stuff, like, and they're all away, everybody in Europe's away, like, Norway's talking about it, like, they've all got plans in place, and like I said, we've got industry going, just give us the infrastructure, and we'll invest. We need to get this right, then, eh?
Hello, Jamie Harcourt-Johnson, I think, must have a brief supplementary, and then Colin Smith.
Yeah, so it's just a brief one, and I could come in on hydrogen, but I'm not, because we'll maybe cover a bit more. But on the infrastructure side, Dominic, I was just going to ask you, is there a kind of slightly uncomfortable question, perhaps, that some of the facilities that we do have, I mean, because, you know, the Macrohanish was, I think, previously Vestas, and then obviously kind of moved through, are some of the facilities we do have simply not suitable for the level of work that we need to be doing? We talked about, I think, eight jackets. you know, during the the oil and gas boom in the North Sea, there was a lot of investment in sites, in particularly in my region, the Highlands and Islands. Some of those are still available, but some of the sites that we've got, you know, Methil or others, are they really suitable for what we're doing, or do we need to almost relook and see where we can investigate, essentially building factories, big factories to do
this? Basically, the land that you've got in these places, I would say, need massive investment. I worked up in Niggenard this year as well, during the North Sea booms as well. I worked in A-yards and whatever. Now, again, while they were turning platforms out and turning them out on time, on budget, and state of the art, there were never any investment was going on to keep them always moving. I can recall the tension leg platforms that came from Japan and ended up in Nigby because the weld fractures on them were phenomenal. And we were working on them as well to repair them to get out. Now, the thing is this, that busy making money, that busy turning the things out, they never ever had the foresight to bring in new measures to make themselves more efficient. Now, again, just on this, because it came up while we're talking here about Cromarty Firth, etc., I worked up at Invergordon just as Innes were threatening to close the plant. I got paid off it. I was a shop steward by Babcock's on Grangemouth. I was paid off and I went up to Invergordon. I was one of the few people up in Invergordon that was actually paying income tax. They were coming from all over the country on bogus self-employed. Also as well, McGregor's boasted about having a totally non-unionised workforce. They've never engaged, and Pat will verify this, in the North Sea sector either. When the collective agreement get ripped up, as you remember, Pat. We were sent round to try and get a collective agreement. McGregor's totally refused to engage with us. So I've got concerns about them actually getting green energy jobs.
The point I was kind of making is, what we've got at the moment in terms of the infrastructure, is it upscalable, or is it that need to really look almost like a longer-term plan? And so, like, if we want to be in this market, then we've got to invest in new sites that can meet for the
future. You will have to. You've only to look at the shipbuilding at this moment in time in the Clyde. While they're building naval warships, etc., at the same time they're filling places in to make totally covered fabrication units where you will bring a ship in there and build it in undercover. And this is the sort of things you will have to do moving forward, because even, it sounds silly, paint guarantees. They're telling you that these platforms will only rust for the next 25, 30 years. You cannot do that in the facilities that you've got in Methil.
Yeah. Okay.
You can't do it.
The other thing is decommissioning.
Yeah.
Because that's another element, isn't it? Decommissioning. We don't want decommissioning to take place where they're taking the platforms, putting them on a barge and sending them to India on a beach, and 14-year-old kids will dismantle them and put their lives at risk. And that's what's happening. I'm not making this up. That's what's happening. We need decommissioning when that's taking place to be. But you need places that are fit for purpose for decommissioning. We just don't have that.
I saw it at Dalesway and Lerwick Port Authority, the work they're doing there. Thanks very much.
Just to note what Pat was saying there about decommissioning, we actually had a situation down at Hartlepool where, a lot of years back, the ghost ships that were going back and forward for America to here where they come into the Able Yard there to get dismantled, because nobody knew actually about these things, what they had been transporting and also what they were made up of. And this is what is happening. Don't forget, a lot of these platforms were made away back in the early 60s.
Yeah.
The ones in Scotland, late 60s, early 70s in Scotland. But other ones came in from other places at that time into the North Sea. And God knows what will be in them.
Now, the evidence we're hearing this morning is important to the committee and is interesting, but we are trying to focus on Grangemouth. We'll maybe pull some of the discussion more pointedly back to the Grangemouth area. Colin Smith will be followed by Colin Beattie.
That sounds like a warning to me. Can I just follow up the question? I mean, I think the points about the need to invest in that infrastructure to avoid us making the mistakes with offshore wind that we made with onshore wind are incredibly well made. Whose responsibility is that? Are we saying this is government that need to take the direction in this? Is that what we're saying? The industry doesn't seem to be delivering on it. So is this about the government intervening more? And I'm very struck, I suppose I'll bring Pat in at this point, I'm very struck in your submission, Pat, about the importance of an industrial strategy and really fulfilling the potential here. What role would that play in tackling some of these issues we've got around the fact that infrastructure doesn't seem to be in place?
I mean, thanks. I do think that you will need government intervention in to get the industrial strategy put into place and the infrastructure. I think because history has shown us that if you're just solely relying on industry itself to make the type of investments that you need to make in order to compete in that global marketplace, it's just not going to happen. It's not going to happen. I kind of see it. So, you do need that sort of investment that other countries have done. By putting infrastructure into place, it's a chicken and egg scenario. Because I remember with the BIFAB stuff, and we lobbied very hard with SSE at the time with Seagreen to get jackets put into the BIFAB yards, and I know the Scottish Government and yourself would have been involved in trying to do that. But we couldn't for the life of us get them to put a jacket in it. Because they'd need confidence in the business itself that was operating it. And no confidence at all in the infrastructure. So you do need to get an industrial strategy across Scotland that's saying, where is the economy moving? Where is the future jobs coming from? We know it's renewables. We know there's a huge marketplace. We know there's a huge marketplace for hydrogen. If you've got a hydrogen plant operating right now, you can sell every bit of that. Germany will take it all for you. They'll take every bit of it. You could make a fortune with a hydrogen plant. Just on the global marketplace, let alone a domestic one, what you could export is tremendous. But unless you've got players, the likes of Ineos, that are prepared to put their hands in pockets, then it's going to be down to governments. And maybe that's a joint thing between Scottish governments and Westminster, because I don't think Westminster can just walk away from this in terms of, got nothing to do with us, Gov, type thing. When you're awarding these contracts through contracts of difference, then I think you do need that investment and a strategy that fits in
with it together, yeah.
And I think Pat's right, because as I say, we were in Norway and we met with the Norwegian oil and energy minister, and he said a thing to us that surprised me a bit. He said, in terms of the wind farms and stuff like that, they're like, look, we're going to import them. Like, we're not bothered about having the skills to make them, right? But their strategy is they want to have the brain power round about it. How do you fix them? How do you make them better? And they're going to export that stuff. They're going to specialise. So their strategy is to specialise in that. They're not so concerned about, if we look at BIFAB and stuff like that and all the stuff you've heard about jackets and why are we not making this stuff in here? Well, Norway are completely different, right? They're saying we're not bothered about all that stuff. What we want to do is we're going to have the ingenuity to fix these things, and we're going to sell that technology. We're going to specialise in that. We're going to open up these centres of excellence where we're going to train our young working kids that are coming through, and engineers and graduates and stuff, and that's where we're going to specialise. So, you talk about strategy and the industrial strategy. Well, they've got one of them, so that they're already away and running on that stuff. They're not even bothered about making it. They're just going to import it. So, and I think about, where are we with all that stuff? And I didn't see that. When we talk to people about this stuff, nobody talks to us like that on that level, eh? So we definitely need to get ahead of the curve on that, and work out what it is. Do we want to build them? Do we want to specialise? Where are we going to go with that stuff, eh?
I remember in here, evidence that was getting at the time of BIFAB, and the CEO, DG Driver, the Canadian company that had the BIFAB yards at the time, gave evidence. We're all sitting here. And he was giving examples of Newfoundland and Canada. He couldn't understand that, they've got an offshore sector clearly off Newfoundland with oil and gas. And any contracts and procurement that gets awarded for there, then there must be a percentage of that gets manufactured in Newfoundland. And if you don't manufacture that Newfoundland, there's heavy, heavy fines that are put on the employers that don't abide by it. And so there's this big penalty that sits there if you don't do it. But the procurement process is built into it. That if you're going, to give you 150 wind towers, you must manufacture X amount of that in this country. That's all in there. And you couldn't understand why. And that's no. There was restrictions with Europe and all that at the time. We're not in Europe any longer. We're at it. So that was the kind of thing. But that's how it operates elsewhere, certainly from that perspective. So, you know, how do you shift? How can you make it possible that when you're getting 150 wind towers, that you can politically ensure that some of that work and some of that, you know, supply chain is in here in Scotland, from a selfish point of view, in Scotland, let alone within the UK, then procurement's the thing. But that's where it gets messy, because you've got some of these contracts getting awarded for Westminster, because it's Westminster that's getting the contracts for difference out. They're getting it to SSE, or they're getting it to, you know, EDF, or and saying to them, there's 150 wind towers off of the North Sea. And then they get it, and then they subcontract. They don't manufacture wind towers. They supply, they're a supplier. So they'll subcontract it to tier one contractors, and it all collapses. So it's what powers does Scotland have within, you know, the powers within the parliament that can stop that from taking place, that says that if we're going to give you all this work, then we want an element of that. We couldn't manufacture it all anyway, even if we wanted to. We don't have the infrastructure to do it. But you need to look at that industrial strategy in terms of that. What procurement, how can you put in measures in place that guarantees work? If you're going to be awarding these big... Scotland, where are we going to go with Scotland? You know, we've gave a lot of the seabed away now to various... Some countries have got part of that seabed. They're going to be putting wind towers up there. How do we make sure that we get that work coming in here? It's through the procurement process.
I'll get any bother from the convener if I start going on to supply chain development statements versus conditionality, but I think it's a very well-made point around Scotland. Can I just follow up on something from the GMB submission, Dominic? We've talked a lot about the importance of Acorn to Grangemouth, and actually the importance of that project in terms of a jobs first just transition because of the opportunities that brings. But I did note a concern in the GMB submission that hydrogen carbon capture have obviously got the potential to create jobs. They're not going to replace the scale of the jobs that are going to be lost in the carbon intensive industry. I mean, do you have a view on what the difference will be between what we can create through Acorn and carbon capture and hydrogen and what we've got at the moment? What is the gap, if you like?
I've not got an actual figure there, but what I'm saying is we've also got the carbon capture down at Drax as well. It's coming up now. They've been talking about this carbon capture for God knows when. I can remember Peter Head way back early 2000s. I remember the White Rose as well, down south as well, and these were going to be massive construction jobs at that time. Now, it's what happens after that, because as they're saying, a lot of this is actually going to go through pipelines into the seabed and whatever. But again, it's not after these plants are up and running, it's what actually happens after that. The likes of we can recognise the likes of Grangemouth and that will still have work in it, and other places will have work. It's how we actually harness this moving on.
So effectively, it's about delivering more opportunities over and above. It's not a silver bullet, effectively.
Aye. What I'm saying is, every concept to make the environment cleaner is actually beneficial to the GMB. I worked down at Corrington many years ago when they were putting filterisation in there because of the fumes, etc. Now, the work that I took... it was all mechanical work, which kept our members gainfully employed. It was a lot of welding, plating, pipe work, etc. It was the same at Folly Refinery in Southampton, massive uplifts of traditional boiler makers' work. And that would move forward as we move forward with these other plants that's going to be made. The initial stuff would be there. But again, what we do not have in this country is pipe fabrication shops. So it's where that's going to come from. We've seen large modules coming in the likes in Grangemouth for Spain recently, or furnaces that was getting done there, because we do not have the facilities here. And this is, again, the supply chain. Again, this is the thing here, Alexa. It's all right having this, and modular is the way to go, where it comes in, and it's then you tie in the welds there, etc., building the plants. But at the end of the day, that might end up 6 months' work here, putting it in. You've lost 18 months' fabrication in this country, where guys would have been working on that before it came out. Again, where infrastructure's not here.
I think in terms of, you know, if you look at any plant in Grangemouth, right, whether it's the KG plant, whether it's the benzene plant, whatever, right, if the future's going to be hydrogen and we're going to build these big plants, right, and this is just the start, right, as Pat said, what does it look like after that, right? So we're going to decarbonise the Grangemouth site there, right, but then you're quickly going to move to, once infrastructure's in place, how are we going to fuel and how are we going to power the country, right? And these plants, it's the same on any plant there for the contract workforce, right? They'll be able to come in and they'll be able to, you know, they'll have big shutdowns, they'll have big set-piece activities, you know. We can't get enough people at Grangemouth at the minute. We've got 3 shutdowns on the new. We can't get enough contractors. That's the worry. Do you know, it's not that where's the work. The worry at the moment is there's not enough people to do the work, right? We've got 3 at the one time. How we quite got there, I'm not sure, but we are where we are. A lot is due to COVID, all that kind of stuff. But so that work will always be there, and this is just the start of the, you know, if you want to talk about journeys, right, but it is the start of the journey, because we're in a real shift, eh? This is a real moment in terms of energy, you know, the scale and how quick this is moving, and people are changing their opinions. I mean, you only have to look at BP, right, like, you know, all of a sudden it's like, oh, we actually are going to drill a bit longer, you know. Elon Musk was at that big conference in Norway, the energy conference. This is the electrification guy, right? This is what he does. He sells electric cars, right? And he's turning around and saying, look, you're going to need oil and gas for the next 20 years. You're going to need exploration for the next 20 years. So if he's telling you that, we all need to be appreciative of the fact that it's still going to be here. How do we decarbonise it? It's going to be through, you know, hydrogen, and it's going to be through Acorn. So these plants, this is just the start of this. You know, what does that look like going forward? Well, that will depend on the decisions that are made at governmental level, you know, and how we legislate and the infrastructure stuff that we put in place. Because, you know, Grangemouth's a massive complex, right? You know, and these plants are going to be there for a long time, like, so there is going to be work for the contract workforce. There is still going to be this, you know, this fabric maintenance and the stuff that goes on, because we're that highly regulated, you know, and you need to do all this maintenance that goes on and on the set, and then you have the big set piece activities, like, so there is going to be work going forward, and as I say, it's just the start, like, and as I said earlier on, we can't get enough people at the minute, and I guess that comes back to the bit that we spoke about right at the start about skills, getting into these schools. You know, it's my son, right? It's Jude Bowen having this conversation about, what do you want to be, Jude, right? And he tells me he wants to play with Real Madrid. And I says to him, well, that's fine, right? I'll be really happy if you play with Real Madrid. But what's plan B, right? So what are the skills that we need for these, you know, for these green jobs, you know? And if it's hydrogen, you know, if he's going to go and work with SSE, what is it? And that breaking the link there between the schools, telling him what he needs to do for these jobs, like, so. And I think if we can get all that right, I think we'll be in a decent place, yeah.
Better with Barcelona, but that's fine.
Okay, thank you.
Team may be better, play me.
Yeah. I'll bring in Colin Beattie to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. I've got a couple of areas I'd like to explore a wee bit, and one of them is still about skills, and you'd think we'd done skills to death, but there's an element of skills policies that I wanted to talk about. In previous inquiries over a period, this committee has noted that some of the skills, well, many of the skills policies are geared towards younger workers and new entrants. Now, that leaves a bit of a gap there, perhaps, and I just wondered, what do we need to do to support the other workers that need upskilling and reskilling? I'm going to bring Ronnie in here. He hasn't had much of a say so far, so maybe he can comment on that.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess from our perspective, so I sit on the skills work stream for the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, and we're looking at all levels. So we've just commissioned a piece of work there with Optimat, who are looking at the sort of industry demand. So that is looking at that existing workforce as well as new entrants, and hopefully, you know, we'll look at both short-term, medium, and long-term jobs and skills that are required. So we're certainly doing it from an industry industry demand, getting that evidence. We'll look at the supply, what provision we have specifically again to the Grangemouth area. So that granularity based on some of the work Gordon mentioned around on CSAP, but this is now drilling down into that Grangemouth level. So from that'll tease out hopefully where those gaps are and where we need to target our efforts in terms of upskilling. Cliff's already mentioned that it should be easier transition in terms of the skills. You know, those jobs aren't that much different to you know, it's a different feedstock, but essentially the job is essentially there'll be similarities with the skills, and that transition should be easier. But yeah, a lot of focus will be on upskilling and reskilling, I should imagine, for the existing workforce.
But would you agree at the moment many of the policies are focused on younger people and new entrants as opposed to more mature workers who need the upskilling?
Certainly, I guess there's a more of a drive towards, I guess young people are more interested in that green decarbonisation space. So there has been a more interest, more focus on apprenticeships for young folk, foundation apprenticeships and modern apprenticeships. But the opportunities are now there. You know, your policy changed, so there's the opportunity there for existing workers to do apprenticeships as well. But yeah, I probably would agree there's a bit more focus on getting new entrants into the sectors.
Cliff, can I turn to you? You were very eloquent in your chatting about how upskilling and so on was happening within Grangemouth. But would you agree with what's been said about many of the policies are geared towards younger people rather than existing workforce, more mature workers?
I think Grangemouth, right? And I'll speak to Grangemouth, right? Because these problems have always been here for us, right? In terms of skill and talent, and because, like I say, people can go and work anywhere on the planet, right? I mean, I could be in Iraq tomorrow if I wanted. You know, my next door neighbour, I was telling everyone just before we came in, my next door neighbour works in Iraq, right? I mean, I could lift the phone to BP. I've got plenty of contacts. I could go and be doing month on, month off in Iraq tomorrow, right? A high level of transferability. Very highly skilled workforce. I'm not just, this isn't about Cliff Bone being highly skilled, right? I mean the whole workforce, right? They could move, no problem. And we've, over the years, it was kind of recognised that we needed a bit more mature workers in, if you like. You know, so we do, at Grangemouth, we do conversion courses. And maybe this is somewhere, you know, I was going to touch on this at some point today anyway. Maybe, so we'll take, like say, for instance, so my friend's son, at the minute, he's just got a job in the refinery, so he went and did a conversion course. He'll do this conversion course. He went for the interviews, and he was a fitter's mate on site, right? So he understood about the permit conditions, he understands about control of work, he understands about working on a refinery, right? He's maybe not got all the academic qualifications on that, but what we've seen is there, he has a certain skill set there that is actually pretty transferable. So we'll go in, we'll take these workers of that ilk and that skill set, and we'll put them in a conversion course that says, right, do we want this guy or this guy to be a fitter or a process technician, and this is what we'll do. And so we've been doing that for a long time there, like, and you tend to get more mature people going for these kind of roles in that way. I think it's difficult, like I said at the start, if you're asking me about mature workers, the kind of elder workers within society, it's hard to change. And everybody likes what they do. You're in this niche, and it's like you're just comfortable in what you do. And it's the example I gave earlier about upskilling and all that stuff. But people do it, and we do offer that. In terms of policy, I'm not sure what you could do in terms of policy, but certainly we could, with investment through the college, and if we wanted to open that up. Into like the green skills, do you know what I mean? So if you tell me, SSE, for example, if they need X amount of operators there, because people are crying out for this stuff, right? People I talk about and people I represent, and if I'm up and down the country, at our executive council meetings and stuff like that, people are looking for another 20 years employment, right? Because they've got kids to feed and they've got kids to go to university and mortgages to pay and stuff. It's real life, this stuff. So people are saying, this is the new oil and gas, right? Well, how do I get to that? Well, you can come and do a conversion course, or you can, but people just need to understand what that is. And if we can get into the schools, and if we can get into workplaces, and you've heard the examples there about the, you know, the pipe fitters' mates and all that, what can we do for these people? Because they are highly skilled, right? Just because you're a mate doesn't mean you've not got a good skill set. And actually, they're the best placed people to probably do these conversion courses, like my son, my friend's son there, because he's now going to become a fully fledged operator within the refinery. So we have these things in place.
Just very briefly, just to. I think lessons that we've learned from the past, even going back to the BP days, is how high you set the bar. Employers at times tend to set the bar quite high. So if you want to be a process operator, you need a master's degree on, you know, something that's there. And it just excludes a whole raft of people that don't have that sort of academic qualification. But actually, they're very, very capable at doing the job that you want to do. So sometimes you need to lower the bar a bit in terms of, you know, the academic qualifications that you need. They'll attract more people and mature people who maybe doesn't have the qualifications to step into that type of role and upskill into through the conversion courses. I think there's a big problem in terms of, because a lot of the language that's been used is news about the guys and the men. It is male dominated, the sector. So how do we get more women picking up these sort of positions that's there, and get them involved more within the sector? You know, do they see a future within that sector that's there for them? Because we do have a distinct lack of women taking up these type of positions, and it's how we diversify and bring more women through.
And I know, to do that, sorry, just before you finish, just on this, with the STEM stuff, eh, we're in the schools, in the local schools, talking, and really, you can imagine, right, that Grangeworth Energy Network, the thing I spoke about earlier on, with all these young engineers and technicians, you know, we're in there and we're trying to encourage more diversity within the workforce, okay, because you get more of a balanced view, I guess, and the science tells you, you know, you have all these different people within a team, I guess. Do you know what I mean? You get different views on problem solving and stuff like that. And certainly around about the STEM stuff. And I know that my son certainly had it within the school from these young engineers. And they come in and they're showing you experiments in the class. And you know, they're really creating a spark for working class kids that are in these schools and that. Like, eh? But we always try and get young females to come into the workplace, like, eh? Because as Pat says, they are. We all have things like, you know, we have our subsector conferences and we're having a women's conference and stuff like that. It's like trying to bring young girls and that along. You can't even get people like in through the door, never mind to get them to be reps, right? I mean, that's an uphill struggle, like any, never mind male or female or whoever. But certainly, we do work on that, like, eh, like say with the STEM stuff, like especially try to create that spark, I guess, for these working class kids.
Gordon, I think you wanted to come in.
Yeah, so your question, I think current policy is focused towards young people. And I think we need to think more about those more mature workers, and particularly those that have kind of missed the opportunities when they were younger. Like a default position is it's the employers that should train them. That doesn't always happen, as we've heard this morning. And I'd reference, I mentioned it earlier, there is a work strand within the NSET, the Economic Transformation Plan, which is looking at that kind of lifetime skills offer, but I'll get some further information from government colleagues and I'll pass that on to you.
Thank you. Dominic, do you have anything you want to add to that?
Well, as Gordon has recognised this, we have got this sort of gap here for the older guys. It's more, I would say it again, it's more a refunding what the guys need, because a lot of it is on-site learning. And then it's getting instructors in to actually sign off books, etc., for these guys moving forward. And on regards of females within engineering and construction, we do have them. But again, coming for the industry myself, and the amount of time I spent away from home on short-term contracts, I'm not being sexist in any way, living in questionable digs, etc., when you could... And whatever, I ended up towing a caravan. And whatever, so I had somewhere decent to go. Is it any wonder females wouldn't want to come into it? This side of Grangemouth refinery, working in there, I get that, the operators are home every night, etc. But realistically speaking, while the engineering construction industry is set in short-term works, you will not get many females coming into it. Or they will come in and leave.
I think points have been well made. I'd like to move on to another area about SMEs. In last week's evidence session, The committee heard that there was a lack of systematic engagement with SMEs on planning for transition. Now, obviously, in the Grangemouth area, there must be a huge number of SMEs that are feeding off the Grangemouth complex. Because they're SMEs, by virtue of their size virtually, have a difficulty in giving time and investing into the process that could limit their ability to engage with the transition. Do you think there's any effective models of engagement that could address these constraints and enable it a better or greater participation? Because their participation is going to be absolutely vital in this. Maybe I can ask you to kick off.
Well, again, it's a good question. I think for focusing on Grangemouth, as the committee has, there's maybe an opportunity to address that issue because of the Green Freeport situation. It's been announced now as being a Green Freeport. And what we would probably like to see is potentially a sort of tripartite meetings then taking place where you've got government involvement, the industries that's involved within the Green Port, including the SMEs and the trade unions, where you can get a tripartite meeting set up to how do we make the Green Port a place where, you know, you've got further future investment for us from a trade union perspective. How do we protect the workforce within that Green Freeport where there's no a drive in doing their terms and conditions and, you know, collective bargaining, and it just doesn't become a tax haven for you know, corporate companies. So you could create a platform through the Green Freeport in Grangemouth to create that tripartite, and that tripartite could address the issues that you're speaking of, for the SMEs. That, you know, you're getting into all the different, you know, transition. There's a whole host of stuff you can speak about within the Freeport area, and just transitioning to Grangemouth will be a big one, because of the nature of the Forth Valley.
Dominic, do you have a view?
I would say Pat's covered that there.
Gordon? It's a big question.
No, I think I would make the distinction between the SMEs that are part, that have skin in the game in terms of being part of that industrial cluster, and I think the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, that will be something that they will need to have consideration of. We're doing some work with Scottish Enterprise just now, who have an SME or a supply chain development programme for green energy. So you'd expect some of that activity to be within the kind of Grangemouth area. I think there's probably a wider issue about the wider community, which is both businesses and individuals, where there's a communication exercise to be undertaken about what the future is going to be. That will play into the school system and I guess give some people some reassurance. So I'd make a distinction, Deputy Chair, between those that have got, a stake in the game in terms of the future of the plant and the wider business community, and we shouldn't forget about them.
I mean, SMEs have are very varied in terms of size. They can be from a few people up to, you know, 30, 40, 50. But they do employ the vast majority of people in Scotland, in actual fact. Last figure I saw for the whole of Scotland, and it may be dated now, was 75% of workers were with SMEs, and I don't doubt that'll be reflected in the Grangemouth area. But the problem is, because of their size, if you're a small businessman, how do you squeeze out the time from trying to run your business in order to engage with planning for the transition, which is going to be absolutely essential that they're part of, and also the costs involved around it. It's quite a difficult one.
I think it is, but I think, like I said earlier on, I think, you know, you talk about transferability within our sector, and I think, you know, a lot of these SMEs, and it's just been alluded to there, they just, you know, they'll just change, you know. And I don't think, you know, if it's going to be hydrogen or whatever, people are still going to need, you know, they're not going to need pumps, you know, they're going to need mobile compressors, they're going to need deliveries of X, Y, and Z, all the stuff that's been, you know, whether it's PPE, whether it's some of the SMEs that provide that for the site, you know, and all these subcontractors, whether it's, you know, whether it's coatings, whether it's paints, whether it's all of that stuff. The industry just evolves, you know, and I think obviously they'll need some support, they'll need some information, but a lot of that's going to come as soon as the gun gets fired on, look, we're going to go for this, you know, here's the infrastructure, you know, government have said this is the plan, then you'll get like the Ineos's that will say, right, here's the 1.2 billion for the plant, this is what we need, that'll change up the stuff we need in terms of safety, this is the coatings that we'll need for the piping, this'll be, an industry just evolves round about that, you know, and now there may be investment, there may be training and about all that, like, but these businesses will have those plans at the moment, and you best be believing these conversations will be happening at the moment, because, I mean, I have a friend who owns a hire company right across for the chemical works, right, and he's all over this stuff, do you know, he'll be saying to me, do you know, like, what do you need in terms of, is it still mobile compression, is it, what is it, do you know, are you still going to need lighting towers, it's all that stuff, and the truth of the matter will be, the answer will be yes, because as I said to you, these plants, although it'll be a different technology and it'll be different stuff you're making, it'll still be pumps, it'll still be compressors, it'll still be passive protection that you'll need, it'll still be, you know, fabric maintenance and all that kind of stuff. So although you're absolutely right, you know, the impact that it'll have, and it is twofold, you know, like say for all the other businesses round about it, but communities that you know, and I see this, you know, because I represent all the refineries and all the big chemical plants throughout the land, business just adapts to this stuff, you know, they're just, and they, this is a good news story for them, you know, it's like, look, there is investment, there is a future, right, I'm going to build that new office, or I'm going to build X, Y, or Z, or I'm going to take on more apprentices, or, so. I think once we get some clear policy in terms of where we're going infrastructure-wise and stuff, and is it hydrogen, are we going to get Project Acorn, everybody tells us we are, but, you know, we need to know we are, you know, and I think for the Grangemouth site and for the area, once we get that hydrogen plant built, you know, I think people are just evolving about that. Yeah.
Rory, just finally, do you see a role for SDS there?
Yeah, certainly. So just on the SME side of things, we work quite closely through the skills groups, and SMEs do give up the time to come along to those groups to voice where their skills gaps are, particular notes around companies like Celtic Renewables, who take the whiskey waste and turn that into a biodiesel. Again, different stage because they've now reached that manufacturing stage. But earlier companies like MyAlgae, who are taking algae waste and using that as a biofuel as well, these see the need to, you know, obviously pick up those workers. The challenge for them is holding on to them. So whilst they've invested in skills and training, you know, do they disappear to an Ineos or further north to Aberdeen? And so that's why they see the need to invest, because they need those skills. But there is a voice. I do take, not all SMEs will voice the concerns, but certainly we've definitely helped on that front. So that's
okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Michelle Thompson, followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you. And of course, as a rule in these committees, the longer it takes for you to ask a question, the higher the probability it's already been asked. So I'm just going to pick up on a couple of things. First of all, Gordon, it was you yourself that made the point about the local community, and also obviously both Cliff and Pat will be across this as well. There are still pockets of the local community, particularly in Grangemouth, who feel that some of the good work that's gone on, even going back to BT days, to be honest, never mind Ineos, despite all the work that Ineos have done in the community, I would say, feel as though that they've been kind of left behind. So I suppose the question is, and I'm aware, I should say as well, the very good work that goes on in a number of parties to try and pull us together, but despite that, where are the gaps you can see that should be plugged to make sure that the local community of Grangemouth can share in the bright vision that you in particular, Cliff, have set out going forward as part of a just transition? So probably if the three of you could give some thoughts about that. Oh, Pat's going to come in.
I mean, community within the Grangemouth area, you kind of reflect back a wee bit, I'm conscious of this, but I'm long enough in the tooth, you know, a Grangemouth resident to remember back to when we had social clubs and, you know, the BP social club, we had the ICI social club, we had the Dockers club, we had snooker teams, we had darts teams, we had all these kind of social interaction where big employers within the area actually engaged within the communities and gave something back to the communities. Who put up a lot over the years, as you were saying, with the flare stacks going off in Grangemouth. So, but you see less and less of that. We don't have a BP club anywhere. We don't have an ICI or an ICI club, and all these things are disappearing. And it was a good way for employers to actually reach out to communities and make the communities feel part and parcel and get some, you know, get some reward, if you like, for being on the doorsteps of big plants like Ineos. So I think work needs to be done in that sense about how do you reach out to the communities. You know, I think you could have like town hall meetings. You know, you could organise town hall meetings in Grangemouth to say, right, we're going to have a town hall meeting, discuss just transition. You can have a panel sitting on that. We would be more than happy. I'm sure Cliff and I would be more than happy to sit on that panel. You could have somebody from Ineos, you could have, you know, local councillors, whatever, sitting on the panel and have sort of the regular type conversations that engages the community across there to say, well, here's where we are and this is what hydrogen is. I think if you spoke to people and talked to them about hydrogen, they'll just go, no disrespect, but it'll go across. If you say blue hydrogen, you say pink hydrogen, they'll wonder what the hell you're talking about. But, and I think the Grangemouth community would welcome it. I'm pretty sure they would welcome that type of dialogue and welcome that kind of conversation. And it lets you bring the community along with you. So it's a no-brainer, I think, for employers sitting there.
And look, I think, as with everything, right, I think probably Ineos as a company undersells herself in this space. Do you know, Pat and I were reflecting on the way through. Do you know, so what we did, what we do at Grangemouth, for example, I'll give you a couple of examples. One is, do you know, a number of years ago, during COVID, actually, like we get like a kind of Christmas payment, like for we go out and have a curry and a couple of beers, right, Christmas night out type of thing. £25 a head. I'm not getting much of a curry nowadays, right enough. But anyway, it's still £25, right, that you could put towards it, right, and it's appreciated for the company, right. But what we did was, we as a collective workers there, we said, right, look. Why do we not donate this to charity, right? Because what difference does 25... We're well paid in our industry, right? What difference does £25 mean make to us? And as I say, I was being flippant there, but you'll not get much for 25 quid anyway if you're going out for a curry and that, right? So what we did was we clubbed all that together. And there's a kind of core wee group there. And what we do is we donated our bonus and it was matched by the company, right? The company put this money in and we donated it to the local, there's a local charity, the Kersey Bank Project in Grangemouth, right? Well. Right. So, and we give it here, you know, and one of the lines I got for one of the girls that work there is some of these working class kids, these underprivileged kids in Grangemouth, there's 100 of them. And I says, 100's a pretty robust number. Why is it 100? And she says, well, we need to stop counting at 100 because we can't help everybody, right? There's only so much we can do. She says, some of these kids almost even get Christmas chicken crisps at dinner time on Christmas Day, like, never mind a chicken dinner. And that resonated with us, right? So we donate this Christmas bonus to here, and Ineos matched that, right? So they end up getting like something like 12 grand or something, I think we gave them this year, do you know what I mean? And I said to my boss, I was like, we should really get this out in the press, do you know? And it's not about... Mm-hmm. It's not about us, it's not about the bonus, it's not really about any of us, I guess. It's about waking people up to the fact that within their communities, and Grangemouth, I wouldn't say it's over affluent, but you know, people are well played. You know, we have the green, amber and red, you know, within the school. I sit in one of the local school board. I couldn't believe it when we had the, you know, the three pockets, the different levels of affluence, I guess, or poverty, whatever way you want to look at it. And we donate it to these kids, like, and it's about letting people within that community know that there are people struggling within your communities, right? So we do that and we go over, and now, and this is the first year we've probably advertised it better than ever. Do you know, it was in the Daily Record, it was in the Falkirk Herald, it was on Twitter and stuff like that. So there is stuff that we also have a thing where you can go, employees can come, do you know, if they do, like, I'm a BB officer in my spare time, do you know, like, so you can apply for a wee grant for anyone else that says, like, look, could you get us football strips and stuff like that, like, so there is stuff like that that goes on, just everybody's busy, right, do you know, and we have a committee that looks at that stuff, so any employee, I sit in the committee, right, along with management, and we say, right, so you would come along and say, look, I do the girl guides, or I do a kayaking club, or a mountain biking club. It's amazing what people get up to in their spare time, right, you learn about people, right, but loads of people are doing fantastic stuff within the community, right. And we'll go along, we'll get them cash and we'll try and match it. You know, you also have the facility at Little Kerse where all the football teams are there. I mean, that's all BPO. I'm going back there, like it's Ineos, but it was BP owned, but it's Ineos owned now, and that's been leased to the guy who runs that place, that facility, guy Stevie Barr, who's a local businessman who does loads of great work in the community, fantastic work. He gave me a free pitch for the Boys Brigade last week, actually, like, so we could take all these working class kids, probably didn't get to play football, and we go along and we get that for nothing and stuff. But he gets to rent that. I'm not going to go into the details of that, but it's a reduced rate that Ineos give them, that, like, so there is a lot of stuff that goes on. Listen, the world has changed, right? You've not got social clubs anymore and all that. And I'm like, Pat, we used to have the BP Gala, did you know, all that kind of stuff. You'd ice-eye club. I mean, I grew up in these places. Like, there was bowling teams, there was hockey teams, all that kind of stuff. And the world has changed. You know, Fordism, all that kind of stuff. The world has moved on for that, like. But lots of stuff there. As Pat says, could we do more? Could anybody do more? I probably suggest we probably could. But we're certainly on that journey. You know, we are doing stuff. We probably didn't sell it as well, like. Benefits of the Just Transition. Do you know, whatever, that will just enable us to be there longer, do you know? And it's probably, do you know, I know that certainly my CEO at FPS, he's offered, do you know, like, so things like if schools are struggling, do you know, like in terms of if it's their heating's breaking down or stuff like that, can we use our contract partners at Grangemouth to go out and go and help? We've certainly done stuff with the Kersey Bank. We're getting them moved at the moment. We're moving them for the Pound Stretchers place in Grangemouth. We're moving them to Charlotte Dundas. So we're doing all the work in the background with the councils, because actually these people are volunteers. It's a charity. What do they know about buildings, and what do they know about building regs and all that stuff? Because actually what we did was we're giving them a lot of money. Right? It's a lot of cash. I think it's probably about £40,000. Because what they said to us was there's working class mothers in this area that didn't know how to boil an egg to feed their kids, which is incredible, right? They don't know how to cook. They can't cook beans, and I'm saying beans, and they're like, no, I'm telling you, right? This is the truth. This is where we live. This is in your town, right? So I went to my CEO and I says, look, there must be something we can do here, eh? So what we've done is we're helping them to move to the facility at Charlton Das. We were going to put a kitchen in Pound Stretchers, and we were going to have the chefs it's Aramac and within the Grangemouth site. They were going to go down and give lessons, but we're moving up to Charlton and Das now, and we're going to do that. We're going to invite all these working class mothers in to come in. We're going to furnish it out, you know, with CBRE and that. They're going to come in and they're going to do all the work, fit it out. Any of us are going to obviously pay for that. They'll use the contractors to fit this place out. They'll have the chef going down to help these working class mothers to boil an egg. Can you imagine? Right? But this is what we're having to do in the community that we live in. And they're doing all that stuff. Big cash. Do you know, tens of thousands of pounds here, eh? People, and that's out with the people who work for the business. People are doing this on business time, as well as the day job. It's like we've taken people for the finance team and said, look, can you go and work with this charity in the locale and go and help this and then get it up and running, get it on its 2 feet, and then what a legacy that is. So there is loads of stuff going on. Could we do more? Everybody could always do more, I guess, for the local communities. But we are there, and we are responsible for, and doing loads of stuff, right, with your underprivileged kids in that area. Yeah. So.
Well, thank you for that. Ronnie, I wanted to pick up on you. It came up earlier about, from a skills perspective, again, I know there's a lot of work going on to make sure that girls in particular can participate, because, you know, just transition, surely part of it has to be that over half of the population actually has some skin in the game, part of it. Can you give us the kind of latest position in terms of your active development to ensure that women and girls are at the Just Transition party?
Well, specifically for Grangemouth, so SDS, again, co-chair the skills workstream with Fuel Change. And yeah, Fuel Change have some great initiatives around the region in terms of taking apprenticeships and an existing workforce on a challenge journey related to a green initiative. And again, many of that involves females to get them to raise awareness of the jobs and the types of jobs that are available, but also the challenges that are facing in terms of that just transition. Other initiatives like DYW will take females through that sort of STEM, getting females into STEM. We have the Women Returners program as well, specifically around that, those areas. And then more generically, there is the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, again, around the careers that are on offer. Yeah. Again, seems to be more... more interest from the female side in terms of those types of roles. You know, perceptions are of the chemical industry in terms of being a dirty industry with the stacks and around INEOS, and now it's changing the perceptions into a greener, cleaner sort of jobs, and I think that'll attract more females into the industry as well.
What I hear you describing is are some good initiatives that are underway, but what I'm less clear is to what extent ensuring women and girls are at the heart of a just transition from now as a fundamental policy of SDS, which is slightly different to good stuff going on. So is it absolutely at the heart
of the... Do you want to pick up on the policy side, Gordon?
Yeah. I mean, I think we will work with government. There's a draft energy strategy and just transition plan that's out for consultation just now. We're actively engaged in that dialogue. I think we need to go beyond the activities to actually start measuring real numbers in terms of the kind of impacts that we make. There is still that gender bias in terms of where people will go, but it's a bit like Cliff was touching on earlier. The guidance teachers and our guidance staff understanding the options and choices that young people should be making to actually help them in that path, and I think we've still got more work to do in that area.
Okay, thank you.
Gordon MacDonald, do you wish to come in with questions?
Just a quick couple of questions. It's been a really interesting conversation. Unfortunately, most of the questions I was going to ask have been covered, but I've got two very quick questions, one for SDS. Most people's perception of green jobs is about renewable energy, electrical transport or energy efficiency. And we had a submission from Select that said that in 2022-23 saw the largest ever number of apprentices and adult trainees recruited into our industry. However, the number of available places funded by SDS falls short of our needs. Can you give us a background to that? Is it a capacity issue? Is it a funding issue? You know, what's driving that?
Primarily a funding issue. The introduction of the apprenticeship levy, and which is applied to private, public and voluntary sector, has created a significant demand. So places like Glasgow Health Board, for example, will pay £6 million in their apprenticeship levy in a year. Police Scotland, Fire Service will all be paying into the levy. So rightly they look to see if they can take a share of that back. We're probably facing a situation over the next 2 years, which we've articulated to government, and it's an impact from COVID and some of the qualification frameworks slowing down, where less people were qualified, with a bit of a spike around things like construction and engineering, which were disrupted the most. And in terms of apprenticeship hours, contingent liability, because we've got 38,000 in training just now, so whilst we get 25,000 starts, you're still getting this flow of people through. Mm-hmm. So we're going to face a bit of a tsunami in terms of the financial cost of that suppressed activity through COVID, and that's what we need to face over the next 2 years. So we're probably, whilst pre-COVID we're at 30,000, they're heading towards 30,000 starts, we're probably going to be at 25 and a half. And there is an increased demand coming through, particularly in areas like aerospace, defence, marine. We're going for a meeting with government, and we met with Mr Hepburn last week. So a lot of the engineering companies are wanting to bounce back. The electricians in particular are unique because they are kind of closed shop, for the want of a better term. They certify their own people, so they've got a great handle on the number of people who are active in the labour market at any time, and they can see the numbers retiring, and they can see the numbers who are emigrating. So I think they're to be congratulated in terms of that industry demand coming forward, but I think we will have a shortfall in the available funds to support not just them, but a number of other employers at this time. And we're working with the government colleagues to try and address those issues.
Okay, thanks very much for that. And my last question is to Dominic. On your submission, your very last paragraph said the fourth Freeport will not result in improved economic benefits for the current workforce or future workforce at Grangemouth. Can you elaborate on that?
Well, unless things change.
What would you expect to change?
Well, again, we're needing massive investment to bring not only young apprentices through, but also adults through as well. It's very clear we're sitting in the worst skill shortage in 40 years. People are going to, and at this moment in time, there's contractors leaving Grangemouth on a daily basis. I'm actually going to meet one of Scott's Pat's colleagues in a minute down at Torness when I go down there, and what we'll be doing is starting to plan balloting the contractors at Grangemouth Refinery now. So every week, obviously, I've got to have records of what I'm going to intend balloting. And the amount of guys that are leaving there the now and are leaving in vast swathes because they're going to other places, again, to get better money than what they're on at this moment in time. So unless things change to keep these guys here, it's just going to be problematic all the way through. Okay. As we said earlier here, just transition's got to be what it says, a just transition where everybody moves on. Both unions have been hearing this phrase for years and years, onshore and offshore and whatever, and nothing's changed.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Graham Simpson, do you wish to ask a few questions?
Yeah, I think it's been a fascinating session. I've enjoyed all your contributions, but I've got to pick you out, Cliff, because I think you've been a fantastic advert for your employer, actually. I know you're not here to represent them, but they've not yet agreed to come before the committee. You've painted them in a really good light. I think that they've got absolutely nothing to worry about by coming here. You've painted a very good picture. We are going to visit them, so if you find out the date, it'll be good to see you on that visit. You've all mentioned, particularly the union guys, this need for sort of investment in infrastructure. And it struck me that when governments introduce policy, industry leads. So, government can do things and then the investment will follow. So I'm just wondering if you've got any ideas, any thoughts on what actually needs to happen to persuade the likes of INEOS to invest more in hydrogen.
I think it's about public transport. Is it hydrogen fuel celled buses and whether we do aviation and all that stuff. Is the appetite there to go after this stuff? Because if it is, the appetite will certainly be there to invest and to get involved in that stuff. Particularly around about public transport and stuff like that. And we all know the benefits. We've seen the studies. We've had a look at the studies ourselves. You say I've been a great advocate for the employer, but I'm actually it's a great advocate for Grangemouth. With this stuff. Like I said to you, if there was an issue here, you would know, right? Because I'm as honest as the day's long. I'd tell you there would be any disparity in terms of where we're trying to go. But it is really a joined up approach, like I said. Any of us want to keep Grangemouth open, and clearly, as a Portonian, I want Grangemouth to be open. I want all these benefits, like I said to you. I would have ripped your arms off when I was leaving school. I think I wanted to play with Real Madrid as well. I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. But 30 years worth of being down there and the benefits that I've enjoyed out of there and the benefits I've seen for the local community as well. And if we can do that, for my kids, for my next door neighbour's kids, whoever, that's why I'm here, to promote Grangemouth, because as I say, we recognise the need to decarbonise. Nobody has to tell us, we're on it and we're doing it. But in terms of policy, it is round about that stuff. Is it buses? So what does that look like? How many buses is it? How many routes are we talking about? Are we going to increase the amount of buses? Are we going to decrease the amount of trains? What does all that look like? And let's have a real vision of what the future for Scotland's transport network looks like. And the UK, right? But we're talking about Grangemouth today, right? What does it look like? Is it more buses? Is it less buses? Is it more trains? What does that look like? Is it going to be, are we going to increase look at the success that bus lanes have been, for taxis for buses and stuff like that. My sister uses a bus now to come into Edinburgh, she's younger than me and we do laugh, because I remember my granny getting the bus to Edinburgh, right? But she says, Cliff, it's brilliant, I go in the bus, there's Wi-Fi, you can kick back, you don't have to worry, you're not stuck in traffic, So if that is the future, what does that look like? So the industry can then model, whether it's an SME, and it's a great point about the amount of, because I think sometimes we forget about the SMEs, but the stats that we had earlier on, we all know what they look like. And if that is going to be the way that we're going to head, just let us know, but let's get on with it, I guess, is the, you know, for your point of view, because I think you've heard it a number of times, like we've been talking about this for a long time, but industry's keen now just to get on with this stuff, and as representatives of the workers who work for industry, we're keen to see that joined up approach as well.
I think on that one, it goes back to the procurement process again. You know, it's a bit like the field of dreams, you know, build it and they will come. If you've got procurement processes that saying that, you know, this is going to generate work and that work needs to be here, industry will develop itself to make sure it's in a place to win the type of contracts and be there. Procurement's got a big role to play in this whole just transition process.
Yeah. But is it not about, I mean, Cliff, you were speaking about the situation in Germany where they're putting in hydrogen filling stations, should we call them that. So if you were to do that here in Scotland or throughout the UK, that creates a market, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, but it's what comes first.
And I guess that needs to be the conversations that you have with the owner, do you know? And like I say, they're there. I mean, richest guy in Britain, you've heard all the rhetoric around about it, but certainly big on UK manufacturing, big on investing in the UK. And like I said to you, these companies can go anywhere, and they are, you know, massive deals in the UK, the US last month, massive deals in China, but they are big on UK and they're big on the future of Grangemouth, so, you know, if we can have that conversation at that level within the company that says, right, look, what does this look like? Because they're certainly having it at the UK level, you know, and this is where Miliband's engaging now, you know, and we can see where things are seem to be shifting on the political landscape, you know, and Labour are really in listening mode in terms of that, so what does that look like? Look, I'm not here. It's not here about Labour, SNP, Conservatives. It's not about that. This is about Grangemouth today. And for me, it's about the future of this country's energy network. It's about the future of decarbonising Grangemouth. Because I've got two kids, right? And I didn't want them to live on a planet that's uninhabitable. Do you know what I mean? But we're still going to need energy. And this is about just transition. It needs to be just, but it needs to be done the right way, measured way. And as Pat says, you know, it really is about, and it's an interesting question, right? Right. I guess it's like this for anything, right? It's about electrification, right? So you know, we're going to have electric cars and all that. Yeah. Well, what happens if you stay in a high-rise flat in the middle of Flamingoven, right? Yeah. I mean, do you know what I mean? Me and my wife laugh about this, right? Because I can't plug my phone in my house to charge it, right? Right, for 3 minutes, right? I turn my back and my kids have stole the charger, right? Can you imagine what it's like if you got four or five cars trying to, fight for the one thing? You go to your work in the morning and it's flat, right? But what do you do if you're like a working class family in a high rise flat and there's six or seven of you in there, how are we going to do that, right? So I think certainly in terms of that whole dynamic about what is it we need to do, we need to sit down and have a serious conversation that says, right, look, these are the plans, what can you do for us? And then they'll be all over that anyway, because they are just waiting. And that's at a UK and a Scottish level to say, look, this is what it looks like, right? We'll fill that gap. We can fill that market because the investment's there. Yeah. Like I say, £1.2 billion for that hydrogen plant. I mean, that's massive investment. That's bigger than anything I've ever seen at Grangemouth.
Yeah.
There is another factor to Grangemouth. We've no spoke about at all in here, and it's PetroChina. And PetroChina's involvement in the refinery itself has got 51% yet. So whilst we speak about Ineos, PetroChina is a big investor within Grangemouth, and it's about what is the plans of PetroChina going forward, and it's sort of short, medium and long term. I don't believe PetroChina is going to go anywhere in the foreseeable future because of the price of oil. The refinery is making shed loads of money right now, as you know the oil and gas sector is. But it's once you get beyond that, and things start to settle down, you know, where does PetroChina go? And I think that's something that you need to speak to within Ineos and within PetroChina to make sure that PetroChina is in the same wavelength as Ineos is in moving the site forward.
And I think, you know, there was a question about Freeport's earlier on from one of your colleagues. And I think, ironic, you know, there's concerns about Freeport's because we've seen them before, right? We understand what the pitfalls can be for workers' rights and stuff like that. We get it. You know, but in conjunction with a lot of your colleagues, you know, we've done a lot of work on this with Mr. Matheson and the like, and we've had all these discussions and we've heard their concerns on Freeport's and the Greenport. But actually, ironically, I think it could be good for the refinery, do you know, at Grangemouth. Do you know, it's probably going to extend its life cycle a bit because of, just in terms of tax breaks and how we can work all that kind of stuff, and we'll see where that goes, But that's not to say, you know, we're sitting here, naive to the pitfalls of the Freeport issue, like, okay, but Pat's absolutely right. Do you know that there was, I've never seen margins like it in 31 years. Eh? The money that refineries are making is incredible at the minute. But you better be believing every refinery in this country that is chatting now about hydrogen, because eh? Everybody sees, you know, that clearly refining as it is hasn't got a future, right? But it has under cleaner fuels, right? And if that's going to be hydrogen and carbon-based, and you look at carbon-capture-based, and we're seeing it right across every piece of investment that's going in, whether it's SR at Stanlow or whether it's down in Fawley, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of pounds being invested in cleaner fuels and decarbonisation and stuff like that. So that's all happening. And it's all around about Freeport areas that are coming, like,
yeah.
Eh, so.
That's fine. Thank you.
That brings us to the end of this morning's evidence session. Thank you very much for panellists for sharing your views this morning. I think it's been mentioned we will be visiting the Grangemouth. That's due to be on the 20th of March. So we'll be doing, the committee will take a visit. And if there is evidence that you've not been able to provide this morning, please do feel free to provide written evidence to the inquiry as we move through the next few weeks. Mr. Bowen, did you want?
Just get my pen.
All right, sorry. I thought you had more to contribute there, but that's him. So I'll just briefly suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you. Which is consideration of an SSI, and the committee is invited to note the diligence against Earnings Variation Scotland Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to update the figures contained in Part 3 of the Debtors Scotland Act 1987, relating to how much money an individual is allowed to keep before any payment can be taken from wages to recover debts, and then sets the scale of what payments can be taken above that level. So these regulations increase protection for those in debt because it raises the threshold beneath which deductions may not be taken from earnings by arrestment. While members are being invited to note the instrument this morning, they will be aware that we've received some representation. So I am minded to perhaps write to the government requesting if they have any future plans, recognising the current economic situation that's faced by many. We do recognise that the instrument this morning does ease that situation, does change some of the thresholds, but we have had representation that perhaps more could be done in future years. And if members are happy, I'll write to the government. I'd also note that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recently carried out an inquiry into these matters as well. So it's something the government is aware the Parliament has an interest in. So if members are content to note and agree that a letter will be sent along those lines. Thank you. I will now, that concludes the public part of the meeting and we'll move into private session.